Hello, everybody. So, welcome. I'm Brittany Robins, Executive Editor of Entrepreneur.com, and it's my great honor to welcome you to this South by Southwest EDU panel on incubating female students into entrepreneurs. According to one study, nearly half of female entrepreneurs say that they don't have any role models, which limits their growth. So in this session, we are going to talk about our wonderful panelists' entrepreneurial journeys and how we can better prepare women to become the entrepreneurs of tomorrow. So with that, I'd like to introduce Kendra Scott, founder, executive chairwoman, and chief creative officer of the Kendra Scott Jewelry and Accessories brand, and Jan Ryan, serial entrepreneur, faculty, and former executive director of entrepreneurship and innovation at the University of Texas at Austin. Welcome. Thank you. Now, let's go back to the very beginning. Why don't you each kind of walk us through your respective entrepreneurial journeys, where you started and how you got to where you are today. Kendra, let's start with you.
Sure. Well, I started my first business at 19 years old, actually. I started a little hat company. My stepfather was diagnosed with brain cancer, and I was spending a lot of time at MD Anderson meeting both men and women who were experiencing hair loss through chemotherapy. And so designed a little collection that was comfortable. I would sew in cotton linings into hats and bring them up to the hospital. And I thought, why aren't there more hats out in the world? And so dropped out of college, okay, and said, I'm gonna go back, parents. I'm just gonna take a little hiatus and do this hat thing. And so did my first business for 5 years, struggling, just selling maybe one or two hats a day. It was so hard. And during that 5 years, really learning so much about retail, learning the good things and the very difficult things, and not understanding during that time that really was an unbelievable education. It was the school of hard knocks, as I like to call it. And after 5 years of opening that store and then failing at it and having to close that store, then going to get a job, I was making jewelry in that little store. And after I closed it, people would call me, not for the hats, but for the jewelry. And they would say, Kendra, can you make another pair of earrings for my friend or a necklace to match the earrings I bought? So I found myself still making jewelry and going, maybe I was so focused on the hat thing working that I wasn't actually seeing what was working, which was the jewelry. And that led to me founding Kendra Scott Jewelry out of my extra bedroom in 2002, so 21 years ago. And started with just $500, made a little collection, and went store to store here in Austin, Texas. Fast forward now, 21 years, and we have over 130 stores across the country. We sell to some of the biggest retailers in the nation, but beyond that, we're able to now support, empower, and educate other women through the Kendra Scott Women's Entrepreneurial Leadership Institute at the University of Texas. So the education that I wasn't able to get through the university, I wanted to be able to take this real life experience of building a business, failing at a business, building another business, and helping other students teach this entrepreneurial mindset so that they could have great success in their lives.
I love that. That's wonderful. And we're going to get a little bit more granular about some failures and also the education piece of this. So, Jen, why don't you kind of walk us through your journey?
Yeah, let me give you a little flyover of my career also. And first of all, let me just say I'm always excited to be in a room full of educators that are just passionate about this next rising generation, because I have a lot of passion there as well. A lot of people know me as an entrepreneur, and particularly someone who cares a lot about the female education within entrepreneurship. But when I was in college, I had no idea I was going to be on an entrepreneurial journey. And in fact, in those days, the word entrepreneur was not as cool as it is now. And in fact, if you had said you were an entrepreneur, it probably meant you were out of a job. But I knew I had this incredible amount of just drive to contribute, and that was just there. And I bet a lot of your students feel the same way. But I felt like I wanted to contribute, and I felt like I had this desire, this almost double dose of curiosity about the world and how things worked. And I actually can relate to students today when they say, I don't really know what I want to do exactly. And I hope that they are not coming to our class trying to find themselves. I really hope that they're coming to our class to be able to create themselves, because being able to widen those horizons is what Kendra and I are so excited about. Getting, you know, to redefine entrepreneurship and leadership, letting them see something that they may not have seen before. But back to my flyover of my career. So I had, as many people do, a life event early on. Sometimes we just have life events that are challenging and that we're not prepared for, and I had that in college. My father actually passed away the summer after my freshman year in college. I was just turning 19. And I remember I was always very close to my dad, so I you know, it was just chaotic with my family right then. And I knew I needed to jump in and help my mom figure out that money thing, because we, you know, had some reversals on the financial side, and I wasn't even sure if I was going to be able to afford school at that time. I was someone who had majored in journalism, so I, to help her and figure out what I was doing, I quickly switched my degree over to business. And you know what? We figured it out. We did figure it out. And it put me on a path that really centered my energies around something very different. I came right out of school and went to work for IBM, which made all my friends say, you know, a technology company, IBM, you know, they remembered me as that dreamy person who liked to write. But I took my dream and put it into a little bit different area, because I was fortunate enough and blessed to be able to be in an age where the personal computer was just being released by IBM, and there was this explosion of technologies. Many of the things we do today that have changed our lives were created during that time. So I was lucky enough to be on the front, you know, seat in the action in a lot of that. And then I went to join a venture-backed startup, and literally I was hooked. For 17 years after that, I was in venture-backed startups as a chief revenue officer, and then worked into becoming a CEO. But what I didn't realize was I was becoming an entrepreneur at that time. Does anyone know what an entrepreneur is? Entrepreneur is just someone who adds value inside of a company. Kendra has a lot of entrepreneurs. In fact, leads you know, a pursuit of entrepreneurs many times. But that is how I learned to create and to have that kind of courage. Ended up halfway through the career, I ended up starting my own company. I was very attracted to anything to do with customers. So my companies were both built around customer analytics. Analytics that understood the customer experience. If you know me, you know I've got this radical customer first orientation that has worked for so many years with me. And it's actually what Kendra and I, when we first got together, we could just finish each other's sentences, because she's the same way. She, you know, starting with the customer first always helps de-risk actually some of the things you're doing. But anyway, just to sum up, I sold a company to Oracle in 2006, and then my second one was in 2012 to Lithium Technologies. And I came out of that experience with this unexplained passion for women entrepreneurs. Because when you've been an entrepreneur and you go from idea to exit a couple of times, you realize how different it is, and it shouldn't be, for women. So that's kind of what started all that. I got recruited over to the University of Texas to help to build something for entrepreneurs in the College of Fine Arts, and help them be entrepreneurs as creatives. And that's where I built this you know, the first class for the Women in Entrepreneurship curriculum. So that's kind of where my background was.
That's wonderful.
Now, Kendra, you kind of alluded to this, but so I'm a big believer that failures and setbacks are kind of where we derive most of our valuable lessons from. So can you go a little bit more in depth about a failure or a mistake that you experienced earlier on, and what you kind of learned from that experience? And then Jen, I'll ask the same. Yeah, you know, I think, you know, I wrote a book in 2020 called Born to Shine, and I start out with some of my biggest failures. Like, everyone's like, oh, Born to Shine, this is going to be a story. Great, it's a story of success. And I go right into, like, some of the hardest times and failures, because what I have realized is that they're truly gifts. And when I look back at my journey and every aspect, not just in business, but in life, in relationships, and in all of those things, I had to go through that difficult moment. I had to go through that hardship, that loss, that failure, to learn the lessons that I needed to learn, those unbelievable golden nuggets of information that I could then take with me to be able to build the thing that was going to work, the thing that was waiting for me, and it was that bridge to get me to the next place that I was going. And utilizing those examples of my own life so others could see it, that when they go through things, and it is hard, and I'm not saying we should look at a failure and be like, ooh, this is great, I'm failing, this is gonna be a nugget of information for me for my future. Of course those moments are hard, and yes, we're gonna go through grief and hardship, but when we can get through those moments and you start to look, what are the lessons I'm going to learn in these moments? What are those nuggets that I'm going to take from this? And how am I going to grow and develop? And as a human, as a person, as an entrepreneur, as a business owner, in my career, whatever it might be. And I think for me, I've really now, when I'm going through those times, I really think back and I go, okay, there's a reason that this is happening. And it may not be there today for me to understand it, but it is going to make itself relevant here to me, and I'm gonna have to pay attention that there is going to be a reason that this happened. And so I think one of the things that, you know, when we teach, and Jan and I have this joy of teaching class together, which has been so unbelievably fun, is I share so much about those failures with my students, and also share with them this, to banish this idea of perfection. We all, especially in this digital world, the world of social media, everyone is perfect. They're smiling and they're happy and they're successful and they're sharing all the good stuff, right? But they're not necessarily sharing the things that are difficult or hard. And so I want to teach them the power in vulnerability, that there's so much power in vulnerability, and that their story, the things that they have gone through, the good, the bad, the hard, that's what makes them unique. There's only one you, and you have a beautiful story to tell through all of those things. And instead of being ashamed or embarrassed or wanting to hold those things in, embrace them as to, these are what make me, me. This is what makes me special. The things that were hard or difficult or loss or failure makes me unique. And then use it as your superpower to create something unique, whether that's a brand or whatever, that's uniquely yours. And I think that's been such a fun thing to get our students to wake up to, wow, I'm not gonna be afraid to say who I am anymore. I'm gonna be proud of those things that I've gone through in my life, and I'm gonna be vulnerable and share them. And then you start to see those students sharing them with one another. And that's when they can truly have these authentic conversations, right? And it's really an amazing thing to watch. And then they become collaborative, and there's not all these fake walls that they've put up of who they want to be or who they want others to think they are. They're able to take those things down. And I really just have loved seeing that. I love seeing it with our students from the day they come in, from their final exam. It's an unbelievable dynamic shift.
I'm so glad, actually, you brought this question up, because, and you said it so well, Kendra, it's really an important topic, especially in education, especially where our students are right now, because the studies still show today that women have a harder time than their male counterparts in bouncing back from setbacks. It's actually quite stunning. They, you know, for instance, they will, you know, they'll have one mistake made, or they'll figure out, you know, that they, what they're working on is not going to work in an entrepreneurship class setting. And then they'll go, I knew I wasn't cut out to be an entrepreneur. Or they'll get a C in chemistry and think about changing their whole trajectory inside of school and maybe even their major. So it's super, super important. And I think one of the things that really makes this class work so well is that we're just open, as Kendra said, about all of those things. For me, for failure, the good thing is I started failing really early. So I started learning these stories. You know, I was back at IBM, remember that, right out of college, you know, brand new whippersnapper coming out. And I actually landed in this, believe it or not, this design engineering group. They were designing new products. I hardly even knew what that was at the time. And my boss really kind of, he believed in me, and he started letting me do some things that he wouldn't let most people do, just trying some new things. I mean, I think back, his name is Jim, how many mentors, you know, that you have, and bless him, we need more of them. But when I started to fail, I started to come up with these ideas I thought were really good, and I went out and I was just failing and failing. And then Jim would just sort of wave away, you know, these failures. But I literally almost asked him if I could be reassigned, because I remember that feeling of just, I'd been a good student, I'd made good grades, but this just didn't feel good. And most of the time, that's where our students are. They're in there where perfectionism, does anybody here, any women suffer from perfectionism at all? It's a common thing for our students, especially at that age, to get the perspective, because they don't want to take something that's too risky, because they might make might ruin their GPA, right? And you can't have a conversation about failure without it being mixed up with risk. And so really having them practice that, having, like, my mentor, he said this thing to me that, you know, failure is the most important tool in an innovator's toolkit, which I had no idea what he was talking about at the time. It's one of those things that you remember years later for context and you think was kind of hokey at the time. But I sincerely mean this. You can't have success without failure. You can't learn. There is no way to do that. And giving them practice, and particularly a safe place to fail in the class, which is what we lean into, really brings those aha moments that are priceless.
That's really poignant. So we're really going to get into the education piece of this now, obviously, because this is South by Southwest EDU. So conventional wisdom kind of tells us that entrepreneurship isn't something that can be taught in the classroom. We hear about so many business leaders who were either college dropouts or who kind of took risks in fields that they weren't necessarily experts in. So talk a little bit about whether you think this is a misnomer and kind of what can and should be taught related to entrepreneurship in the classroom setting.
I mean, for me, as somebody who didn't get to finish college, here I have a school at the University of Texas, and now I'm called Professor Scott, which is like, I can't even get my head around it sometimes, right? I always giggle when they say it. But the reality is that I understand the importance of always learning. I wake up every single morning and I'm leading a company bigger than it was the night before. I have to learn. And I was able to go, because I didn't have a typical ability to go back to school, life took over. My stepfather died of cancer. I had to close that business. All of my friends had graduated from high school at that point. I had to get a job. I had to pay my rent. Then I tried again, as scary as it was, and I didn't tell anybody I was starting my jewelry business. It wasn't this big, hey guys, I'm gonna open hundreds of, you know, jewelry stores across the country. I really just wanted to be able to provide for my family. I had a newborn baby. I was very quiet about it, but I wanted to learn. So I would read every business book I could, from Tipping Point to The Great Game of Business to you name it. I was just like absorbing these leaders, right, and trying to learn from them. And in 2006, 4 years after I had started my business, I had joined an organization called Entrepreneurs Organization. I wanted desperately to meet other entrepreneurs, people who had gone through similar things to me. And they had told me about a program at MIT called the Entrepreneurial Leadership Program. It used to be called Birthing of Giants, was the name of it. And amazing entrepreneurs like John Mackey from Whole Foods, Michael Dell was involved in this organization. They would choose 65 entrepreneurs from around the world, so around the globe, to come into this program for a three-year course. And I wanted this because I wanted the education. I was told that because I was an artist, I was a creative, that I could never be a businesswoman, that I could never be a CEO, I couldn't run a company. And I started to believe these things that people would tell me. Oh, I'm a creative. I don't have the business mind. But I didn't want to believe that. And I walked into that class, and here were these amazing entrepreneurs. There was only four women out of the 65 in 2006. By the end, in 2009, because of the Great Recession, I was the last standing woman in the class. And I remember going in and thinking, I don't belong here. I'm not smart enough to be here. I shouldn't be in here. They probably just have me here because they needed to fill a quote for a woman to be in this program. And I remember my instructor saying, one of you is sitting in a billion-dollar seat. And I'm looking around like, oh, it must be the guy from India. It's got to be the guy from Australia. I'm sitting in the back of the classroom, you know. And learning, though, the tools of the entrepreneurial mindset, learning those foundational tools over those 3 years for fantastic entrepreneurs and thought leaders, I built the bridge in my brain between the left and the right side. I got the tools I needed to be able to be a good leader, the foundation of being able to utilize my creative skills as a superpower to be a thoughtful and exciting CEO and an amazing leader to my team. And that bridge I wanted to teach every single person I knew after I finished it. Because I thought, it's not true. There is no such thing as left and right brain. You just need the tools. And so one of the things when I went to the University of Texas is I said I'd love to work and create a program for women that helps them learn the tools I learned to bridge those gaps within themselves and know that they are not put in a box. And I want to go to every major, not just the School of Business. I want, you know, they're getting taught entrepreneurship. Why can't somebody in the School of Education learn about the entrepreneurial mindset? Why can't a woman in the fine arts department who is the beautiful art learn how to build a business through her, what she is creating? Why does it have to be specific? And so that was a really challenging moment at UT, and fortunately met Jan Ryan early on, who was like, oh yeah, now you're speaking my language, sister. And together we kind of did what was never done, the impossible possible. And what we saw is the power of these students who would never meet each other typically. So we've got engineers, women in STEM, we've got women graphic designers in marketing, we have women that are in the fine arts. We put them in these collaborative teams to find white space in a market, come up with a solution, and pitch a business to us at the end, a Shark Tank pitch. And they see the power now of, not everyone should look and do the same things. We all can have the same heart, but it's awesome that I have somebody that has this expertise, that their strength is something that I'm not good at, but when we work together, we're able to create and achieve something that is absolutely phenomenal. And it's just, I mean, I get giddy, if you don't notice. I'm like giddy about it, because we get to then see that this is working and it's true. And so for me, it's just been such a passion. I think I would have loved to have been able to finish school. I consider myself a UT grad in my heart. I've always wanted to be at University of Texas, but this is my way now of being able to do it for the next generation and hopefully lead by example.
Kendra, can you tell us who was sitting in the $1 billion seat?
I was.
Let's give a round of applause for that. So I kind of wanted to go into the next question, which sort of piggybacks off of what Kendra was talking about. So how do you think that traditional schools can kind of better provide women students with the proper tools to become entrepreneurs? Can you share a little bit about your class, some of the exercises and coursework that you do with your students?
Absolutely. And by the way, I don't feel that you can teach entrepreneurship in a classroom. I think it has to go outside the classroom. I do absolutely believe in entrepreneurial education, but it has to be experiential. I think that until you actually experience what you're teaching, that it doesn't penetrate through, and theory doesn't cut it. I think, Kendra, you would agree. It's not about theorizing. You actually have to get out there and fail and iterate and pivot. But in terms of traditional education, what's missing, I think we do a pretty good job today in entrepreneurial education in leaning more toward experiential. One of the things that I think we need to understand for women, though, which can be kind of controversial, really, do you need to bring women, you know, and make them separate or keep them in the, you know, keep them in the middle of everything else? Of course, we don't want to take women and put them away from men. This is not the way real life is. But the truth is, if you really want to start an entrepreneurial program for women, I believe you need to first realize that it is a little different for women. So there is just some mind shifts that need to happen with women. You know, studies show over and over that there is a lack of confidence many times with women, that it is actually something that they don't hear a lot of things about some of the issues they want to hear inside of traditional entrepreneurship classes. They may have some in the back of their mind, some issues about balance of life, about having children. Can I still be an entrepreneur having children? They need to be able to talk about that. So having one class that enables them, and this class is 30 women in this class. I have actually over 100 applications every semester for the class. The idea is to make it very, very diverse. As Kendra mentioned, you know, just to literally pick someone from every school, every discipline, every skin color, have someone, you know, pick people that are first gen, bring them together with those that are, you know, fifth generation, you know, sorority, engineers, designers. It literally is an extremely diverse class, semester over semester. And what you get is a lot of creativity, the ability for them to recognize new things, learn new things from each other. Many times they don't know anyone in the class when they first come in, which is almost unheard of, as siloed as our systems are today. And then they start to work together. But another thing, when I was saying, to understand that it's a little different for women, think through how they can understand how to drop their guard. Because women are so perfectionistic and many times care what other people think, and they come from parents potentially that want them to be in a certain major, that need them to be very, very, you know, oriented in a certain way. They need to define themselves. So they need that opportunity. Actually, class was just last night, and we did a round table where I do it every semester, where they have the ability to share about self-advocacy. You know, it's kind of tricky for women to self-advocate. We have articles that we give them and examples, and then they get to, in this roundtable, share among themselves. Again, dropping the guard. It was wonderful to see they were advocating for each other by the end of that session. They were talking about, oh, you have a problem with that, you're so great at this. We need to help them understand, as women, how to be powerful. And then go back out. They don't need to be by themselves, cloistered off, but they do need to have the ability to sometimes just feel like they can talk to each other. Women are just wired differently. We learn from each other, don't we? We just need that. Give them a little bit of that to get that confidence, and then definitely equipping them with the same skills that you would in entrepreneurship, but changing the mind shift a little bit so that they have the ability to go out and lead.
And just as a follow-up, I know you said that you have 100 applicants at any time. What are some of the qualities that you kind of look for in candidates?
Well, obviously, someone who really wants to be there, and someone who, and by the way, it's not just put out there for women. We occasionally have one or two.
Yeah, brave men.
Yeah, brave men, and they always turn out to be there for the right reason. I'm amazed. They actually want, you know, they have a single mom with four sisters or whatever. I never knew early on what that would be. But basically, those that want to be there, those that have shown that they are entrepreneurial in some way, usually they have some side hustle, but they don't have to. They can be put into a team. They may be just wanting to meet other entrepreneurs and entrepreneurial women. But it's very obvious when you have something be application only, whether someone wants to be there or not.
That makes sense. So, you know, it seems like when a woman becomes a successful entrepreneur, it's still framed as somewhat of a novelty. And obviously part of that is just women trying to catch up in a male-dominated field. But I'm curious if you either of you actually do think that there is a lack of women role models for entrepreneurs and why that may be the case.
Kendra? 100%. There are more CEOs named John than there are female CEOs. Okay, so that's a problem. And it's something that makes me want to continue to just fight right so hard for those things to change. My dad, you know, I have so lucky, and I do think it's so important to talk about the male role models in our life. I mean, some of the best mentors I have are successful male entrepreneurs who believed in me. My first investor, Steve Hicks, was an advisor and a mentor, and he was the first one to ever say, I want to invest in you. And I hadn't heard those words. 10 years I was trying to get somebody to invest in me, and I finally heard those words. So I think it's so important, first of all, to acknowledge that. I had a father who was very entrepreneurial in the fact that he was a lawyer, and he calls himself a country lawyer, but he put his little sign out and he passed the bar in both Wisconsin and Illinois, so he thought he could get twice the amount of business. And I'd go to his office after work, and I think having that was so amazing. My mom was a Mary Kay consultant, then became a director and created this little business out of our laundry room, and we would package up her Mary Kay orders and deliver them. And I watched her do this and be still a thoughtful mom and be there for us, but still have a very, she had the Jan's Jewels because she became a director, and those were all of her consultants. And I saw this in those little things, right? They imprint in you, they become part of you. And it was such a great example. And so having mentors, having women that you can look up to, part of the Women's Entrepreneurial and Leadership Institute is our mentors. We have a mentor session. And it's not just entrepreneurs. We love bringing in female entrepreneurs, but I want to bring in leading researchers in medicine that are women. I want to bring in women in STEM. I want to bring in other leaders, female leaders, so that these women can say, wow, there's somebody that looks like me, or I can see myself in her. And I think the more that we're able to do that gives that little girl, like I was with my mom in the mudroom, packing up, you know, Mary Kay orders, going, I want to grow up and be like that. I can do that, or I can see that. And so I think that's such a powerful thing, and it's absolutely necessary. But you don't have to be at the top of your game either to be a mentor. What we're really leaning into is saying, you have a career, you're within a career, how can you come and start coming in and mentoring these students after you've left the gates at University of Texas? Because there's so many stages of growth from when you leave college to where you become potentially a CEO, right? And so I think that's an important part too, having this, you know, vice presidents of companies or senior directors of companies mentoring these young women is also such a powerful thing. So yes, we need that. We are so excited when we see women excited to support them. And I always say, if we can get women to shift that mindset of being competitive, that a win for a woman, a success of a woman in her career or in business is a point for all of us. That is a great thing. And so instead of us having this mindset of, oh, she got lucky, oh, I don't know why that happened, we have to teach our younger generation that we are not going to stand for that anymore. And that when we see a woman successful, look at her go. I am so excited for this. Because when we hold hands and lift each other up, we are unstoppable. And there will be more female CEOs named Jane than there will be men CEOs someday if we start to have that mindset.
So agree. I also think that there are a lot of role models potentially out there. It's just that we don't have access to them. And even if you're wanting to build a program, one of the core aspects of that needs to be surrounding them with people that look like them and that talk like them. And that's what we do in this class. We have a stream of women entrepreneurs and mentors, a big mentor night, that come in so that they can see them, carefully chosen to be very diverse. Because there's more women out there and men that want to mentor and be role models, that we don't facilitate it sometimes, which really, you know, disturbs me, that we need more of those programs. I really believe this, and I mean this from my heart, that this is a noble effort, if you get into it, to help young women, this rising generation, because they're going to be the ones that help us get out of a lot of the issues we have as our nation, in my opinion. They're going to be the new leaders that they have a natural ability to work across the aisle. They have a natural ability to be collaborative. They, when they are successful, they give back to the community. This is the kind of thing that if we can enable them to feel confident enough and to bring more people together to mentor them. Mentorship is a big topic beyond what we're talking about today, but if you're wanting to build a program, those types of things are what make that energy happen, and that's what makes it really successful. So I would agree that we don't have enough, but yet I believe we've got more than we're taking advantage of in terms of mentorship.
That's great. So I'm going to kind of flip this to a more positive note. So obviously representation is still a little bit scarce, but we have seen an increased number of female founders taking the spotlight in recent years. How do you think this will kind of impact future generations of women who want to become entrepreneurs and kind of take that leap into business, Kendra?
Well, I mean, you know, look, it's an exciting time for entrepreneurship in general. You know, I think as a shark, I got to really witness during the pandemic, I was so scared that, like, is entrepreneurship going to die? Are we all just, you know, and I got into this, you know, quarantined situation for Shark Tank during 2020 and saw that the entrepreneurial spirit is alive even more than ever. And maybe this hiatus of COVID, of the pandemic, actually sparked business ideas or things that people were percolating, like thinking, I've always wanted to do this, but their life kind of had taken over so busy prior to the pandemic. So I'm seeing more and more founders in general, but so many female founders. Many females left the workforce to take care of their children. It was unbelievable, right? But during that time, they were actually, many of them now, starting businesses. So while they were home taking care of their kids, they're like, this is my opportunity to try this thing that I've been thinking about. So I'm really excited because I think we're about to see a big increase in more female founders. This is my, you know, of course, I always look at the silver lining of everything, but I do think this is a huge silver lining for the pandemic. And I think it's an exciting time, and I do think we're seeing things change. I think having young individuals see women in power positions, whether that's women running companies, female CEOs, female executives, whatever it may be, that is an inspiring thing. And I want to tell you one thing that I always loved my dad had said to me. He said, Kendra, as I'd go in and I would try to pitch my business and get money, right, all the time, and it would never work. I'd get told no every which way you could possibly get told no. And he goes, don't let the men in suits intimidate you. And I would walk in these rooms and no one would look like me. And so I started to wear a gray suit, pantsuit, because I thought, well, maybe if I look more like them and talk like them and act like them, then they'll invest in me. Well, I was absolutely wrong, because what was appealing about me was that I was colorful, that I was a female, that those were the things that were gonna make me different. But it took me getting that self-confidence. And so I think for all of these young, you know, this younger generation to see women that are proud of, I am a woman, I'm proud that I'm emotional, I'm proud that I have these things inside of me. They're not negative, they're actually my superpowers. And let's utilize those things to be kind and thoughtful leaders, and not be afraid to say, I'm trying to be something I'm not. So I'm really excited, if that's the bottom answer. I'm very excited, I'm extremely optimistic, but we have a lot of work to do still.
I am also extremely optimistic. And well said, Kendra, on so many fronts. I think that, and I do a lot of work with female entrepreneurs in the corporate setting as well, and I am astounded at the number of black entrepreneurs, women that have just said, you know, I'm sick of trying to play the game of not making enough money when the men are making money, and I'm just gonna go start my own company. Something like 61% of the new companies last year were black females. And so it's astounding. When I look forward at, you know, 10 years from now, I think it's going to be a big difference in what we see. I also think it's changing things like management styles. We're already seeing that. It's becoming much more, you know, empathy is now something we can actually talk about with leadership, right? Women are influencing management and leadership, but they're also creating companies that affect women's lives. They affect the healthcare environment. Their numbers are incredible about how many females are starting companies inside of healthcare environment. So I have just high hopes about what the impact of women are going to be. And honestly, about the Women's Entrepreneurial Leadership Institute and how that plays a role in changing and sending out more women across the nation.
We love the optimism. Kendra, you kind of alluded to this again. So one of the key areas where we continue to see a huge discrepancy in the world of entrepreneurship is funding. Women receive somewhere between 2% and 7% of all venture funds for their startups. It's likely on the lower side of that spectrum. So what are some ways that women business leaders can kind of overcome this hurdle?
Well, I mean, one of the things, and I mean, I even saw it today, my good buddy Kevin O'Leary posted today how more of his female-founded businesses are the ones that are the successful businesses, yet we are receiving less of the venture funding. So Mr. Wonderful actually wrote something that I actually approved of today on his thing. I gave him a clap, you know. But it's so true, right? And I think, you know, when I started and I go back to 2002, the access to capital for women was very difficult to find. I mean, it wasn't just you could go out and find these funds that existed, you know, that were even focused on female founders. I do feel like now we're seeing this shift, and we're also seeing whether that's PE firms, whether it's venture capital firms, understanding that in their portfolios, their female-led companies are outperforming their male-led companies in many cases. So that is good news, right? Because when, you know, they're looking at the data, they're looking at the facts, and like, why are we going to continue to invest in female founders? Well, these founders are actually showing up and doing what they say. They're profitable. They're doing good business. And so we need to just continue those conversations. When I look at PE, and I obviously have taken in private equity over the last 21 years a few times, you know, I would go to these firms and there were very few females in this industry, very few females in this financial side of this business. And so I have all these men, they're like looking at my company and like, well, where are the women on your team? Like, where are they? Well, we've got Betty, and I'm like, what does Betty do? She's your assistant. Okay. Well, what about, who are in here? And we're starting to now, I'm seeing that change also, where they're realizing we have to bring in people within our organizations who understand the importance of finding female-founded businesses. So we are seeing a shift. Berkshire Partners, who I work with, one of their leaders within that organization is Marnie Payne, a female, and one of the reasons why I chose to work with them, because she understood my business, she understood my core consumer, and I felt like we had an aligned vision of where we wanted to go. So I think all of those changes are things that are gonna continue to have to happen in order for us to see a real shift in those numbers change over the next 5, 10, 15 years.
I so agree. And women investing in women, I would add to that, you know.
And I love investing in women.
It's a major push. I think if you think back to education, what can education do? That's where education really plays a role, to teach young women more about all these acronyms and all these things that seem so cryptic and that they don't understand. In class, we have a session on just helping them understand what those actually mean and dispelling any of that mystery around it, so that they're able, if they're wanting to go raise capital at some point. But some companies don't need capital in that regard. They need different things. And so just helping them understand, helping also women who need to raise venture, how to plan for that earlier. And if they need capital or they're going to need capital, it's too common that often women wait to the very last minute and say, Jan, can you help me get funding? When truly, if I were talking to a young man, it might be that he had been having coffee and talking about this, getting ideas long before he actually needed the money. it's so important to start thinking, getting networked in, who is out there, what are the options. It doesn't have to be just institutional capital. There's a lot of other ways to get capital today. Angels are very important in that
arrangement. I always love that, you know, we joke about that people would tell me, well, Kendra, you got to get an angel. I'd be well, yeah, great. Yeah, where do these angels hang out? I do need an angel. They just come to my doorstep. Now there's actually angel networks and things you can access. But back in the 2002, it was like, yeah, I would love to meet an angel. I mean, that's a great idea. But there are now, there's so much more accessibility. And I'm like, I feel like I'm a dinosaur. But because of the internet, you know, we're able to access so much more than we could have ever before.
And I totally agree. And the last part is just consciousness needs to be raised among the institutional capital that's out there. We need to keep continuing to do that. Pressure from the media, they need to understand that we really do have a new world today. And these companies are going to perform, but they have to have some money to be able to do that.
Wonderful. So before I ask my final question, we're going to have some time for audience Q&A. We have, I believe, some stands over there if you would like to line up and ask Kendra and Jen some questions. You can do that as I'm asking my final question. So I'm curious what advice each of you wish you could have told your younger selves when you were starting out in business. Ending with a bang.
I have a question because of that question that I ask at the beginning of every one of our semesters to our students, and I ask them to really think about it and not have to say it aloud, but are you more loyal to your dreams or to your fears? And do your actions actually show that? You know, when all the things that we're doing and we care so much what other people think, are you actually more loyal to your dreams or your fears? And I would just tell myself early on, stay with the dreams. I love being a dreamer. I love projecting forward what could happen. And I think sometimes we don't realize it, but we're staying closer to what our fears are than what we actually could be doing. So that's what I would tell myself.
I would tell her, you know, this is a moment in time, and to take a breath, and that it is going to be okay. And that truly your journey is part of this great, great thing that you're on, right? And that the failures and the things ahead of you that are going to be really, really hard in life are not going to stop you. They're actually going to be your fuel to propel you forward.
I love that. All right.
I'm a senior in college, and I just wanted to say hearing about like the work that you did with the University of Texas and like all your failures was so, so inspiring, so thank you for that. But my question is, if there was like periods of time throughout like your work where you weren't feeling confident or you didn't feel like you belonged, how did you kind of like pull yourself out of that?
I mean, there's many times, and there's still those moments. I mean, people think, oh, you know, Kendra, you're at this top of your game. I still have those moments sometimes of insecurity or feeling like I don't belong or not, you know. And what I've started to do is just quickly just go, I gotta let that thought go. And also take ownership of what I don't know and be okay with that. And I always say asking for help is the greatest sign of strength. It is not a sign of weakness. And so in those moments when I'm feeling uncertain, I would rather pick up the phone now and call somebody that I know has maybe gone through something similar, that this is uncharted territory for me, but they've already gone and said, hey, do you have a second? I got a quick question for you. What would you do in my shoes right now? I've got this dilemma. And when I do that, I'm learning. I'm always learning. And then quickly, I feel more confident because I'm like, okay, not only did I, now I understand something that I was worried about, but I also feel like I could then help somebody else when they're going through that. And I think for me, I've never been afraid to ask for help. And those get me through those moments.
Hello, my name is Amanda, and I'm from Fort Worth, Texas. Go Frogs.
I love your yellow hat so much.
Thank you. First off, I want to say this is awesome. I'm an educator myself, and I'm currently working on my doctoral degree. So is this class open to students that are working on their graduate degrees to get their terminal degrees, or is it just a bachelor focused class? And is it just one class a semester y'all do, or is it an actual like program that if you take it, you know, in the fall, can you continue into the spring or that sort of thing?
Well, currently we are for undergrad students in the classroom, in the coursework, but we are for, in the Kendra Scott Women's Entrepreneurial Leadership Institute, we have different programs and different things that are happening that can be from from anywhere, actually, even from the community. But that doesn't mean that's all we're doing. We're still working on a lot of things to come in the future. We have recently gone under the McCombs School, which is our business school at the university, to become a minor. And so that's why we now are only for undergrads. But there's so much need. I speak a lot with the graduate students for more. But right now, the actual classwork is for undergrads.
So we launched this just a few years ago, and when you look at the vision of what we want this to become, we really want it to grow into all aspects. And we see so much power in even our alumni. I mean, our alumni are so engaged and involved in wanting to come back and help and be resources and help inspire and mentor. So I think there's going to be so many opportunities in the future. But to have this right now as a minor for any major, so again, at School of Education, I keep going back there, you could have a minor in Entrepreneurial and Leadership Institute. That's really amazing and something that hadn't been done before.
Do y'all offer it in the master's level as well? Like, could you just...
Not yet.
Well, currently, not yet.
Not yet. Emphasis okay. On
check,
yet.
Check back.
And also, I want to say the Marin earrings that sponsored this, one of my favorite pair of earrings. So, great job.
I love it.
Hi. Oh, I'm short here. I got a lot of my name is Jamie. I'm from New Jersey. I'm a podcast co-host, actually, on education. But we actually have friends we've interviewed who have a book right now. They're presenting here today. It's called Innovate Hers. And they've interviewed women from around the world who are successful, entrepreneurs, have that entrepreneurial mindset. And one of the things they've noticed is that commonly women don't, if they see a job posting and they say, oh, I don't have those qualifications, so I'm not gonna apply. Men, on the other hand, just go for it anyway. Regardless of whether or not they have those qualifications. Both of you have alluded to female superpowers. And I wondered, you both said that you have a customer-focused businesses, that you're very customer-focused. Do you think that is part of that female superpower, that empathy that we all have? Do you think there's a commonality there?
Oh, can be, absolutely. Not always. But absolutely, women are just better, more empathetic. They understand what's happening with their customer. They, you know, they get that. It is absolutely a superpower for women. Not all women are customer-centric in their businesses, but they would be if they understood how powerful it truly is when everything you do is centered around what the customer's latent needs are, what they really care about. So yes, I do believe it is something that women can even do better. But it's not always an automatic thing.
I mean, I work for my customer, and I tell everybody in my company, she's our boss. She signs my paycheck, she signs your paycheck, I am not the boss. The customer is our boss, and every single day we have to go in and surprise and delight her. We can never be complacent. We have to understand her, we have to understand her needs, we need to meet her where she's at. We need to know her like our very best friend. And that all comes from this heart that we as women have and this bond, right, of like wanting to lift each other up and be there for one another. And there's a level of warmth and understanding. And I think as a, you know, now I'm chairwoman, but as CEO for 20 years, of also being able to relate with my teams and say, you have a full life. This is one part of your life. You may be a mother, you may have all these other, you know, activities. I wanna make sure that your entire life is happy and healthy, because then you'll be happy and healthy at work. We have very low turnover at Kendra Scott because I'm able to have those conversations. It's not work, 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 and then hopefully, oh yeah, you're gonna miss your son this, your mission. No, it's the opposite. It's what do you need and how can I support you? And listen before just talking. And that is a total female-driven, almost motherly instinct that we're born with of nurturing. And I think that's such a superpower as a leader and something we should be so excited and proud of.
Yeah, and also making sure that you are encouraging that balance because it is so important not to let it go. And that is one of the other themes in that book that I mentioned. Actually, one of the authors works for Mr. Wonderful, actually.
Oh, I really
like you go.
All right, we have about 5 minutes left.
I'm a little taller. Hi, I'm Charity, and I'm from Canada, Calgary. And
I'm from Canada, too.
I am an educator, but I stand before you as a parent today. I have a 17-year-old daughter who has this beautifully awesome idea that she could be an entrepreneur. My father was a very successful one, so I see it in her. But she feels like she's to go that traditional route. So she's looking at, do I do engineering? Do I do architecture? She's a creative, but she's so smart in many other ways. So as an educator and as a parent, what would you say to those young girls who have that in them, you see it, but they just won't go there because they feel they have to go the traditional route?
I would just say get practice being outside your comfort zone. Any opportunity you can give her to do that, that's part of what our class focuses on as well. I always say that your comfort zone is where your dreams go to die. And
yes.
The more you can give her experience in that, the more she just is going to relax and feel comfortable in her skin and start to use some of those ideas. But it's again, it's experiential. So I would just say look for those opportunities.
I couldn't agree more. I am a mother of six from 9 to 21 years old. My 18-year-old is very similar when you're talking about your daughter, super creative, has so many ideas. One of the things he's really passionate about is food and cooking, and someday wants to own his own restaurants and all these things. And so I said, well, babe, you know, he's in college, but like you've got to work in that industry. You've got to learn from the best. And so he's able to go. He gets up at 5 a.m. on Mondays. It's his one day he doesn't have class. He works from 5 to 5 as a prep chef in a sushi kitchen here in Austin. He is so excited, so driven. He's learning so much about this industry, and I just see that spark in him. So if there's any opportunity for her, whether it's internship, experience, you know, whatever it might be, I agree 100% with Jan. There's nothing that can ignite that fire inside of her more than being able to have some hands-on ability. And then there's that balance, right, of like you have to take certain classes, but at the same time, there's so much opportunity in school today where you want them into something that you're passionate about. And if she's learning about something that she's excited about, it's not going to even feel like she's in school.
That's what I tell her all the time.
Yes.
She's got a little side hustle that she does with cake baking.
Yeah.
But,
aw, awesome. I love that. Well, and I love that you're such a proud mom.
Oh, yes. Thank you.
I'm a little short, too. Hi, my name is Rhea. I'm a student. I go to University of Texas, so welcome. It was beautiful hearing both of your experiences and journey, and happy International Women's Day to all the women. And and I know talking about role models, so who is someone you look up to, and how do you stay motivated to do what you do?
Great question.
I know, so many. Go ahead. I think my father is a role model I still look up to. There are so many other role models that I know. Many of them are in venture capital, women who have braved into that world, mostly in Silicon Valley. I wish a lot of them were locally there. And what was the second part of your question?
How do I
stay motivated? I just can't tell you how mission-driven I am. So when it comes to latching onto a mission, I need no motivation. I get out of bed eager and ready to go. So I would just encourage everyone to find that North Star in their own life, because it just changes your whole life to be able to have that mission in your life. So I stay motivated by the progress that I'm making toward that goal.
Yeah, you know, it's funny, I would have to say my father as well. My dad and I are unbelievably close. We talk every single day still. And he's just always been this positive role model. I remember even when I was getting bullied in junior high school, and I would be so sad, and he'd be dropping me off, and he'd be like, honey, kill him with kindness. You know, go in there and kill him with kindness, and put your shoulders back, and, you know, keep that smile. And he's been that believer in me, even when I didn't believe in myself. And those times have happened and continue to happen throughout my life. And I think it's so important for us to have someone, whoever that might be, that sees the good in you, that sees your possibility, that sees all of those things. Because we will have days that we say, oh, I'm not good enough, or I can't do this, or this is so hard, why am I doing this? And I can always rely on picking up the phone and having this burst of support and love in my dad. For me, I am extremely optimistic person, and I'm always thinking about tomorrow and what we can do and what we could build. And I'm driven by just because of, I get to see the phenomenal gifts we're giving to give to the community. You know, my business is kind of fashion for philanthropy. I believed that I could build a fashion brand that could do good in the world. And since 2010, we've given over $56 million to women and children's charities. That drives me like you wouldn't believe. You know, it's not necessarily the next collection, which I love, and all those things. I get up and go, okay, if we did $56 million and we are supporting all of these women and we're doing these amazing things, I just feel like my time on earth is fleeting. And I think that's what motivates me, is I just want to do more while I've got the ability to take a breath every morning and do it, because I have lost people I love and I've lost them early in their life, and I just have this sense of urgency.
I think that's a great place to finish. We're a little bit out of time. Thank you all so much for being here. I hope you found this panel to be informative and enlightening. And of course, thank you to Kendra and Jen for sharing your valuable insights. Just one housekeeping note. Kendra will be having a book signing at 1:15 at the Austin Convention Center in room 10C. So go say hello. If some of the people who were hoping to ask some questions, you can ask her in person.
And the book tells you all the things,
yes,
all the dirt, all of it.
And happy International Women's Day, everybody.
Yay!